So good morning, all of you. This is a student during exams, and don't worry, we've all been students. We've all gone through this. This is from the Bible. I walk through the valley of shadows of death. At exam time, we all are extremely scared, and in that scare, we forget our basics, which is unfortunate. And that's what we are here all for, because all these ophthalmic subspecialties require a structured patient examination of common case scenarios. Nobody will fail residents if they just answer the must-know areas. Good-to-know areas may not be answered, but must-know areas should be, which should be a tailored history taking, basic examination with diagrams. In your case presentation, always put a diagram with color pencils. Okay, that will score many marks for you. Like for fundus examination, you should have an AMSLA chart with diagrams. For cornea, for gonioscopy, just put the diagrams in. Additional investigations, and then we have a commonly asked questions. So this is my expert team, Dr. Ratanam from Aravind, she'll be talking about uvea, myself from Gurnanak Eye Center about cornea, Dr. Madhu Bhaduria for glaucoma, Dr. Amitava from Aligarh Medical University for strabismus, Dr. Krishna Kumar for orbit, and Sagarika Patel for neuro-ophtha, and Shalini for glaucoma. Okay. No one can whistle a symphony. It takes a whole orchestra to play it. And that's what I have with me today. So these are the scenarios we'll be covering. Fear has two meanings: forget everything and run, which most of us want to do at exam time, or face everything and rise. Choice is ours. So let me start with the corneal session. Cornea wala laga dijiye, please. Can I have a pointer? How many of you are residents here? And how many of one? Oh, that's good. That's fine. Morning session? That's pretty good. So good. This is structured for you. And how many of you are exam going residents? Okay, so some of you still have time. That's fine. So what is the examination technique which you're most afraid of? Till my slides are on. Cornea wali, please. Dr. Kirti Singh ka lecture. Yeah. What is the one which is most terrifying, or most, not terrifying is the wrong word to use, most difficult? Sorry? Squint. Yeah, squint. Same for me, actually. It was the same for me. Cornea is one of the easiest, but please remember, cornea case will always be given to you. Exam, viva, topography, drugs, everywhere cornea will come. So, algorithm for corneal exam is, please, in the corneal exam, don't forget the adnexa and lids, the meibomian glands. Please start my time now, sir. Aapne pehle, hello, audiovisual people, please. Timer start kar dijiye ab, because aapne pehle wale ka timer kar rahe hain, introduction ka. So, algorithm, adnexa and lids. So, please do evert the lid. That's my first tip to you. When you're taking a corneal exam, lid evert. Do evert the lid, because you will otherwise miss out on the papillae and other things. To the roplas. Very often we'll say, roplas, oh ma'am, we forgot. That's part and parcel, okay? Corneal shape, clarity, size, sensations. You may not have an esthesiometer, none of us have it. You may not have a cotton wisp. You have to tell the examiner, I wanted to take the sensations, I could not, okay? Opacity, of course, all of you know. Carry your fluorescein strips with you just in case the examination hall doesn't have one, okay? And of course, slit lamp. So let's come to slit lamp, that is the basic. We all know the seven types of examination: direct, diffuse, focal, indirect, specular, and the sclerotic, scatter, and retro. Out of these, the focal and the diffuse is the most important, and then you must go for specular because of shortage of time. If you have any problems in the corneal opacities, then go for retro examination, okay? In the algorithm, in the cornea, even if it's a cornea case, do a tonometry. Don't think that it's not a cornea, it's a glaucoma case. It's not a glaucoma case, tonometry is not required, because very often herpes or corneal opacities, PKs, you would need a tonometry along with it. Then, this is the viva things. You won't be asked to do these in the exam, but keratometry, topography, specular microscopy, AIOC2020. The viva will go on these things. Okay, these investigations, basic. Why, where keratometry, why not keratometry, because only central zone is taken. Pentacam, what's the principle of pentobank, shimp flux, obscan and coronal topography. Obscan and pentacam are the latest things, you should know about them because these will come in the Viva Voces also. You'll have invariably topography map there with them. These colors, remember, as I said, I stress on diagrams and most examiners do. Black is limbus, scars, degenerations, foreign bodies, sutures, contact lens, and BSKs. Okay, so you should carry your color pencils. One diagram is worth 1,000 words. Okay, that diagram will speak for you. And you can't undo it, you can't redo it. Okay, brown is pigmentation, Krukenberg spindle, pupil, and iris, and iron or melanin pigmentation. You have to draw it on the cornea, the back of the cornea. Color blue is for edema, diffuse is stromal edema, and small circles is the epithelial edema, okay? And wavy lines, moment you do that, is Descemet's. If you have this diagram, the examiner will not even ask you anything, go through it, and then you will have a DViva, okay? Because they realize that you know about it, okay? Red is blood vessels, then deep are the straight. If you draw a wavy line, it means superficial vessels. If you draw a straight lines, it means a deep blood vessels. Okay, rope staining also is in red. Again, rope staining is not very frequently given to you in the exam, but they can be asked. And hemorrhages, of course, which is not a very common thing to see. Orange is hypopyon, and KPs also fresh ones. Now, orange, you will not rarely have a case with hypopyon, very rarely, unless it's the other eye. You know, other eye may have a hypopyon, you won't be given an active corneal ulcer to see. Green is fluorescein staining, any epithelial defect. The viva will go on the vital dyes and the non-vital dyes. Punctate epithelial keratopathy, filaments are small lines, okay? So, and green dots are punctate keratopathy, and the shades are epithelial defect. So color pencils, green, red, brown, black. And so this diagram, take a picture of this. This just shows you all the colors and how to code them. So the first message going to you is lids to evert, second roplas, third corneal diagrams. Clear so far? Okay. Then fourth is corneal opacities. These are three ways of depicting opacities. Nebular is shaded or stippled lines. Macular is straight lines. And leucomatous is standing and sleeping lines. And adherent leucoma will have a brown circle like this, which means the iris is adherent to it. Size of the opacity, you can very easily measure on the slit lamp reticule, but please do remember for the examiner, you must magnify it depending on what lens you're using. For the slit lamp, of course not, but if you same thing you're using the reticule for the disc examination, you must put the magnification factor in. So let's get to this brief video of what we've talked so far. So diffuse elimination, okay? Just have a look at the cornea. Lids, you are meanwhile seeing, you have averted the lids, you checked for roplas, okay? Revert the lids, look for the palpable conjunctiva, okay? Limbal dermoid, very obvious. BSK, very obvious case. Granular dystrophy, very obvious case. KF ring, not so obvious, you'll have to look for it. This ulcer, you will not get in the exam, but you should know about it. Hypopyon, corneal ulcer. Okay, so this all will be seen in diffuse. Focal, make a parapolyploid. Okay, look for KPs, look for scars, look for lattice dystrophy. Okay, and look for pigmentation. And very often you'll have a case of lamellar corneal keratoplasties. That will be visible on the focal. Okay, this is a case of lattice. You can see the lines. This will be very clearly seen on retro also. So learn to do these step by step so you will not miss out things. When you go back to your places of work, do these step by step so that in the exam it becomes a spinal cord reflex. Okay? Retro. This is the retro technique. You will see the dislocated or subluxated lens very well. You will see a conus. Okay? So retro also is very useful in the corneal exam. Torchlight. Leave it for the last. But do it because Rizzotti sign is very often missed. And torchlight will give you the Rizzotti sign. Eclipse sign will tell you about the angle depth. Okay. DDO, Charlex oil droplet sign. Okay. You will see in the conus patients with DDO. You will see RD with DDO. You will see cataract with DDO. You will see corneal opacities with DDO. So DDO is one of the most important things. And this comes as part and parcel of examination. Evaluation of the cornea. Now coming to very briefly about few case scenarios which were giving the exams with some Viva questions. always you will get some case of keratitis, healed, never active. Okay, so please, when you have an act, or if you have rarely an active case, do not do a contact test. Do not do tonometry, do not do sensation, and do not do any touch technique, and tell the examiner, I did not do it because this was active ulcer. That will give you brownie points. Okay, then non-healing, the viva will go on non-healing ulcers, complications, perforations. Hyperpeon, as I said, again, very rarely you'll get a case. You'll get a spotter, actually. When you get a spotter like this, the question will go on to which organisms pass through an intact epithelium, which you should know. Okay, and what are the types of fungi or the types of virus which infect the eye? The viva very often goes on to neonatal conjunctivitis. That case is never given to you, but you should know about that. Herpes are very often a case scenario. You'll have a healed herpetic case. The answer very often people make a mistake is, which is the commonest herpes infection? The answer would be dendritic. The answer actually is thoracic shingles. He has not asked you ocular. If it's ocular, yes, then you asked about ocular. But if the question is commonest herpes infection in the body is thoracic. Okay, then all the epithelial stromal, HSZO, herpes zoster ophthalmicus, is a protean manifestation and can affect any part of the eye. Okay, and the treatment you should know about. IK, if the patient is of IK, the viva will go on HEDS trial, roll of triggers, topical steroids, oral acyclovir. So you should know the HEDS 3 trials. This CUT trial, the recent trial, you should know about these two trials about the corneal cases. PU case, again, you will not get a question, most probably won't get a case, but always you'll get a topography map on these. Okay, so the kissing crab appearance or the beaked appearance of the parrot's appearance, that is very typical of PU case, okay, with the with pellucid. So you must identify these topographies, okay, and then you can talk about the management of topography and the viva invariably, if it's PUK, it'll go on Mouden's ulcer. So types of Mouden's you should know about. This case will very often get, again, trauma, aphakia, usually co-linked. Okay, then the types of trauma, how do you manage your trauma? And once you get a trauma case, the viva goes on to dangerous area and sympathetic ophthalmia, okay? Then foreign body removal, hemosiderosis, chalcosis, ERG, and everything, you have to know about that. So trauma is, again, a case. Limbal cell deficiency, very common case. Acquired case, you should know all the classification, you know, the management, primary and secondary. Aniridia, again, can be a case in itself with a corneal case, with the limbal cell deficiency. Treatment should be known. Types of chemical burns and types of classification, Duas classification or the Hughes classification, whichever one you're using. Okay, the staging of that. Dystrophies and degenerations, again a common scenario. Retro should be done. You'll have granular, lattice, or macular. Any earth can come. Epithelium can also, very rarely will come, but mostly it'll be stromal dystrophies. VK's case, specular microscopy should be done, and you should tell them if you can't do it, that is too dense for me to do a specular reflection, okay? And VKC case, child, very often you'll get a VKC case. You should know about VKC and atopy difference, and this is, again, these are viva questions or spotters. BSK, Bittort spots, Pfister classification, vitamin deficiency. These are must-know areas. Again, these are all must-know areas in the vivas, okay? Euphthalmos, very rarely you'll get this case, but if you do, then it's a cornea and a glaucoma combined, and tonometry is usually not possible, so digital tension you should do, okay? And in any glaucoma case, you should talk about the amblyopia treatment. Keratoconus, again, a must case. Always I've discussed about keratoconus already, the staining, the fit pattern. You should know about the contact lens fits, the types of contact lens, and how the fit changes post-high drops and how and collagen cross-linking. Okay. Flictons and OSSN, that's more into ocular surface, and you will get that. Dry eyes, ek slide aur hai. On kar dijiye. Dry eyes, this is a drug viva actually. Invariably, this will come with a drug viva. With the drugs, you'll have to cover dry eyes, and then it'll come as a spotter. Keratoplasty types, DMEK, DALK, DISEC, indications, rejections. You must always differentiate rejection from failure. How is it too different? Failure can be any cause. It can be glaucoma, it can be dry eyes, it can be primary failure because of the poor graft quality, whereas rejection is only immune-mediated. Vital stain characteristics, these staining, again, this diagram, if you draw with a dry eyes patient, you've done the viva well, okay? So to conclude, in the year of 2020, we all expect you as residents to walk through the exam with 2020. Thank you. Can I have the next speaker? I'm sorry, I'll have to leave Dr. Ratnam and Dr. Abu on the dais. I have another IC which I'll just run and do. And the next one is Shalini is here. Yeah, Shalini is here. So Shalini will talk about glaucoma cases, primary glaucoma, operated filter, secondary glaucoma. Dr. Shalini, any cases keep for us? Keep for us the case, your questions, we'll answer them. Thank you.
Good morning, delegates and student and respected dignitaries on the dais. At the outset, I would thank Dr. Kirti for this opportunity to interact with you residents. So just now you saw a wonderful video of how to examine your patients. Now, examination is extremely important, and to identify the clinical features is equally important. Even if you are not able to make the diagnosis, doesn't matter. But if you miss a finding, then definitely it is going to matter. So let's see how and what to see in a glaucoma case. Now, first and foremost thing is, you know, the history part is extremely important. In glaucoma, you might not be getting any symptoms. In primary open angle glaucoma, there might not be any symptoms, or maybe some brow ache or hemicranial headache. There might be history of frequent change of near glasses. Then family history of glaucoma is also very important, so you need to emphasize that. And then obviously refractive errors might be associated with glaucoma, so you need to ask the patients regarding the spectacles. Not just this, there are some other associated things which might be associated with glaucoma, like history of steroid usage, history of trauma to eye, or any other secondary disease like uveitis, any intracranial disease, and then you know that normal tension glaucoma can be associated with systemic disorders. Sleep apnea might also be responsible for progression of glaucoma. So you need to record all these findings in your history. And if it is not there, you can say that it is negative or about these findings. Well, you know that systemic medications, they do cause glaucoma, and not just steroids, other antidepressants, they might also lead to acute angle closure glaucoma, and therefore you must note down what all medication patient is using. Now let's go to examination. We need to do comprehensive examination, record visual acuity, and then detailed examination I will be discussing in subsequent slides. So what are the cardinal measurements which we do in glaucoma? We might not be needing any sophisticated instrument to diagnose a patient of glaucoma, but yes, we need to do a good applanation tonometry. Second is, we need to do gonioscopy to find out whether it is an open angle or a closed angle glaucoma. Third, a 90D examination on slit lamp, that is stereoscopic view of the disc, and finally the visual field. So when we talk of visual acuity, it is not important only to measure it on Snellen's chart, but you need to check the perception of projection of rays also. Because sometimes the vision might be perfectly all right, he might be reading 6-6, but because of constriction of visual field, the projection of rays might be defective. So you need to record those findings also. Then diffuse light examination is very, very important. Just throw your torch on the face of the patient and see that there might be sometimes dilated episcleral vessels, as you see in the second photograph, or there might be a red eye in the patient who is having headache, vomiting and everything, and then you see a red eye, then the diagnosis which comes to your mind is acute angle closure glaucoma, right? So these kind of findings you will see on diffuse light examination. Similarly, a child who is having capillary hemangioma like this might be a case of Sturge-Weber syndrome, or a patient with this kind of nevus might be a case of nevus of OTA. So do an external eye examination, which is extremely important. And then simultaneously you are using a torch, do a pupillary reaction also. Sometimes in cases of advanced glaucomatous optic neuropathy, you might see that patient is having a relative afferent pupillary defect. Then coming to slit lamp examination, go from anterior to posterior. Just now you saw in the video shown by Dr. Kirti that we need to see one structure at one go, like for conjunctiva, go to cornea and then to anterior chamber. So regarding cornea, you must see what from the anterior layer of the cornea till posterior layers of cornea. You might be seeing a case of corneal edema. You might be seeing a Krukenberg spindles like this indicating a pigmentary glaucoma, right? Similarly, in the lower photograph, you can see keratic precipitates which might be associated with iridocyclitis, or you might see a congenital bufthalmos eye like this having a tram track appearance, and that signifies that patient is bufthalmos. Then don't forget to raise the eyelids. Sometimes what we do, we simply go and see with the slit lamp and we see the eye and then we forget to raise the upper eyelid. It is very, very important because sometimes our laser iridotomy might be hiding under the eyelids, or sometimes there might be a filter, a bleb, which is hiding beneath the eyelids. So you must never miss doing this procedure. Now coming to anterior chamber depth, Van Herrick's is the procedure which is done for screening. You have to make a thin slit lamp beam at the limbus and then check the depth of the cornea and the anterior chamber. And then you can compare the depth of the anterior chamber and you can decide whether it is shallow or not. Coming to iris, iris is extremely important because you might see posterior synechia or you might see irisotrophic patches indicating that there might be a previous attack of subacute angle closure, or patient is having viral keratouveitis, or you might see a Fuchs heterochromic iridocyclitis like this. Similarly, you might see transillumination defect which indicate a pigmentary glaucoma. Now, not just iris, you must see the margin of the pupil, which is extremely important. Now, here you can see that there is a normal pupillary ruff. If there is any deficiency in the pupillary ruff, you know that there might be a subacute attack which has led to loss of pupillary reflex, or you might see this kind of white chalk-like deposits at the pupillary margin, and you know this is a case of pseudo-exfoliative glaucoma. In traumatic glaucoma, you might see that there is a mid-dilated pupil with loss of sphincter, and then sometimes you might be seeing a neovascular glaucoma. So margin of the pupillary is extremely important for you all. After this, we need to do the examination of lens. Now, it is important to do dilated examination except in cases where you suspect angle closure, because in dilated examination, you might see these kind of ring, and you know what are these rings signifying? Pseudo-exfoliative syndrome, right? Similarly, here you can see that there are so many pigments at the anterior lens capsule. Now, here you can see there are subcapsular opacities, just as you see in glaucoma flecken, that indicating that there was a previous acute angle closure attack. Or sometimes you might see this kind of washer's ring indicating a traumatic cataract. Then obviously you might be seeing a subluxated lens like this. So lens examination not just gives the diagnosis, but also gives you the etiology behind the glaucoma or what is going inside the eyes. Now, as I have to cover the operated filter also, so it might be in immediate post-operative period, like after you have done your trabeculectomy surgery. So doing a Seidel's test is very, very important. Sometimes you might be seeing a Seidel's positive like this, as you see here. And that means that if it is an immediate post-operative period, you need to intervene there and then and close this conjunctiva so that you don't have Seidel's positive. If it is in late phase of trabeculectomy, that you might be having a weeping bleb, and that is, there is likelihood of infection, and therefore you need to again intervene in this particular situation. Well, in operated filter, you might be having a failed bleb like this. Now, once you are having a failed bleb like this, you need to do a gonioscopy. And if you see that there is an ostium which is patent like this, you know that yes, needling of the bleb will help in this particular patient. So you go ahead and do the needling. But suppose you have a closed ostium like this, then you know now no needling is going to help and you need to do another trabeculectomy surgery. So it is not just about diagnosis, it is also about managing your patients by just simple examination and simple tools all you are having. Sometimes you might be having overhanging blebs like this, and you can see thin wall cystic bleb, and this might be again a foci for infection. Then you can assess the bleb morphology also, that whether there are presence of microcysts, whether you have, what are the amount of conjunctival vessel, whether it is a avascular bleb, or the shape of the vessels, like if they are corkscrew vessels, that means that there is likelihood of failure, presence of encapsulation and height of the bleb. Now let's see, this is a avascular bleb. Here you can see a failing bleb with few of the conjunctival vessels. Here you can see a slightly angry looking bleb, and this is the typical corkscrew vessels which are indicating that this trabeculectomy procedure is likely to failure. So you need to give certain antimitotic drugs to prevent this vascularization. Now, gonioscopy, as I have been emphasizing, is extremely important to make your diagnosis. So you need to see all the structures starting from Schwell baseline, trabecular meshwork, scleral spur, ciliary body band, and root of iris. Now, gonioscopy is the procedure which you all must learn, and you need to identify the findings also. So like here, you can see there are peripheral anterior synechia. There are peripheral anterior synechia like this, or you might be having angle recession glaucoma like this. You might be having a hiding ciliary body tumor or a foreign body like this. So again, documentation, as just now we talked, is extremely important. If you have a peripheral anterior synechia, you need to draw it with the help of a orange color. Regarding depigmentation is purple, pigmentation is white surrounded by a black line, and then blood vessels, they are red in color. So you need to draw your diagram, label it properly so that it gives you a recording and you can maintain your data. Regarding intraocular pressure, Goldman applanation tonometer is the gold standard. You must clean and properly, then only you make sit the patient. Don't forget to clean the tonometer properly. Explain the patient and take a proper consent. Now, dilated disc examination is extremely important, especially if you are doing with any of the lenses, you need to multiply it with magnification factor. Red-free examination you must do, and then again document your findings like this. If you don't, just one slide more. So you need to document your findings like this. If you can't take a photograph, but you can always draw a diagram like this, write down the size of the disc and the vessels, and then you can document your finding. So visual field examination is a separate talk, but you must all know about this. And so to conclude, I would say it involves a strategic approach. Comprehensive eye examination, including slit lamp, IOP, gonioscopy, and dilated disc examination, and then correlate your findings with visual field. Thank you so much.
Okay. So let's see how much we can go through strabismus without getting cross-eyed. We'll be looking at esotropia, and it's two important variants, the standard infantile variety and its elder brother. That means the one which onset is after 6 months, which is acquired, non-refractive, but they're very similar otherwise. And this important chap we look at, the refractive esotropias, and this one is actually a mix of the above two, partially refractive. Then we look at exodeviations, which are actually on a spectrum between a tendency, an intermittency now and then, and to the other extent where it's manifest all the time, an exotropia. And we look at duanes, and I prefer the option of calling them as esotropic duanes, straight eye duanes, exotropic duanes, because that makes so much sense to me, rather than type 1, type 2, and type 3, and the synergistic divergence. And this is important, that the infantile esotrope usually have a large angle, and it's usually also a constant angle. And the catch when you have little kids is, you know, kids are moody. They may be sleepy, dopey, not very interested on a particular day. Call them again a couple of weeks later. Get two readings which are within 5 prism diopters of each other. Because unless you're confident about your measurement, you can't, you know, plan a dose of surgery here. This slide conveys everything that you really want to know about an infantile esotrope. Onset before 6 months of age, big angles, 40 to 7. 70 prism diopters, and it's a constant deviation as different from variability. You see, a variable esotropia must have a variable cause, and that's accommodation, variable amount of accommodation. If the kid has hypermetropia or a large AC by A ratio, every time they make a little accommodative effort, they'll converge. If they make more effort, they'll converge more. If they're dopey and sleepy, not interested, they won't converge at all. So variability is part of a refractive situation. Constant, it could of course be uniocular or alternating. Alternating has the advantage that maintains visual acuity in each eye. So, and this is important, even newborn children, do remember that even the macula hasn't matured, even if the child is born after 9 months. Macula is still evolving anatomically and physiologically. So in the initial couple of weeks, children's eyes may not be very well organized. That's okay, especially if it's a slightly exo. But persisting ESO deviation beyond 2 months are very suspicious. Time to get a consult. They often cross-fixate, seeing the left part of the world with their right esotropic eye, right part of the world with their left esotropic eye, and they are therefore reluctant abductors. So sometimes you need to spin them around, you know, to ensure that they can, you stimulate their optokinetic nystagmus. And what I do is hold the kid up, spin around in the clinic, and because the world rotates around for the child, you should see optokinetic nystagmus. Be careful that you don't fall here. You can spin around the other way around. Get some of your residents to hang around just in case you're about to fall here. The other trick is to perhaps patch the fixating eye. Call the kid after some time, and the esotropic eye is likely to have moved out here. And these are some of the motor and amblyopia is often found. So do suspect it, look for it. There are motor anomalies. And I've got the mnemonic of pond, and I like to tell my resident that think of a little infantile esotrope standing in a pond of water. Pursuit asymmetry, overactions of the obliques, N for nystagmus, and D for DVD. These are often found. You need to have them in the mind. You need to look for them. Otherwise, some of them are discovered after surgery, and you wonder whether did you miss it earlier or has it come later. It, of course, could be true either way. So here's a case of an alternating esotrope, remember. Good visual acuity, or at least equal visual acuity in each eye. They all need to be refracted. I'm not going through those things. It's very basic. The way to go for alternating esotropia or near alternating esotropia are bimedial recessions. They're extremely successful. Under general anesthesia, of course, you can discharge the patient the same day. It's again, you know, you need to, of course, hang on to them for a couple of hours. Like your anesthesia colleagues have advised you. If of course it's uniocular esotropia, suspect amblyopia. That's one approach. Everybody deserves one good effort at anti-amblyopia therapy, and nothing beats a patch. And what I do is I ask for a two-inch micropore. It's dirt cheap. I encourage them to use an old rupatta or some soft cloth at home. Cut out an egg-shaped thing appropriate for the child's eye, stick it on the micropore, cut around it so that there's a little sticky part of the micropore, works as an excellent patch, costs hardly 2 paisa for each patch, and to be put onto the child. If the child is a little older one for anti-amblyopia therapy, I tell them, even if they are unlettered, they can get a newspaper from some neighboring chai ki dukan and encourage children to fill up with little felt pens, sketch pens, anything larger, like a big T, Hindi ones, or O's in the English one, and you get all sorts of headlines, all sizes. Encourage them to go from larger to smaller sizes. And give them a good, you know, return, make their favorite food, that kind of thing, some sweet dish that they're fond of. The other thing I want to point out is, if you have a large horizontal deviation with a small vertical, one question is, should you really do anything for the vertical? For the small vertical. So one trick that Jampolsky suggests is that you sit in line with the deviated eye, for example, in front of this eye, and the fixating eye, you ask the person to fixate on some object and move it horizontally. So he's going to track you with the fixating eye. And as you can see, the other eye, because of Herring's law, will straighten out horizontally. At that point, with your torch and sitting right behind him, behind the torch, looking along the barrel of that tiny torch, ask yourself, is it vertically aligned also? If you think that it is vertically aligned with a pure horizontal movement, then that's all you need to do. You need to do only horizontal muscle surgeries. You don't need to do a vertical. That's what Jampolsky suggested. also long, very often, I'm from Aligarh, from medical college there. I'm often getting people who have had infantile esotropia, but they present very late. These people will also have abduction deficits. Very likely to have amblyopia, which is unresponsive to therapy. You know, at 22 years of age, unlikely the amblyopia will improve. And these people, they have restrictions to abductions, and they naturally need some weakening. They are also reluctant to have you operate on the other eye, even if they're large angle. And we've done some true muscle transplantation, where the resected fragment is attached to the recessed muscle, so it's elongated. And here's the other chap, the refractive esotrope. These ones will have variability. Ask the mother, kabhi aankhe seedhe ho jaati hain ya nahi hoti hain, or is there a variation, especially when the child is a little dopey. And they do very well with the refractive correction. Normally, what is recommended is about plus 3 diopters of hypermetropia is where you are likely to get something. If in doubt, tell the parent you are trying a trial of glasses. You know, sometimes you need to do that. This one shows you partially refractive, 50 prism diopters, corrected with five diopters of refractive correction, down to 30. And that 30 residual angle is what needs to be done with surgery, tackled with surgery. Some of us tend to forget that the glasses the children may often be wearing, they also have built-in prisms. Like a convex lens has basin prisms, concave lens are prisms pointing towards each other, and they affect your measurements. In myopia, you see, like in this guy, this eye is to the right. In a case of a myopic lens, there'll be a prism which is like this, built into the myopic lens, and you're going to put prisms pointing in this direction to measure. And this prism in the glass will oppose your prism bar. So your measurement will be far in excess of the truth, because this prism is also got to be, you know, corrected with your prism. So you tend to measure more. And the mnemonic here is myopia measures more. This kicks in as important when it's 5 diopters or more of refractive this correction. Hypermetropia, you measure less. So keep that in mind. Exodeviations are often intermittent. They could be in small children also. So you can see straight-eyed, deviated eye. And they could be anywhere in the spectrum. And these children can depend. So if you're going to have a morning clinic and tell the parent, bring your child on the way to school after he or she's had a good sleep, they may perform better on your cover test. And if you call the kid on the way back from school on the steaming summer day in India, he or she may not perform very well in the afternoon. So there'll be a lot of variations of this kind also. The alternators, again, they have good visual acuity. Exodeviations are classified as basic, between essentially very similar between distance and near, or they measure more at distance, in which case they are called divergence excess. Because many of them are, of course, truly so, but some of them simulate divergence excess. And they do that because at near, they measure less. And two reasons they do that: they measure less exo at near. One is because they have a high AC by A ratio. So every time you do it at near one third, they do three diopters of accommodation that kicks in with the multiplier, the AC by A ratio, and they measure less. The trick is put plus 3. If they're measuring less exo at near, put plus 3. Take off their demand for accommodation. They should expand and now be almost the same as the one at distance. And the other one is to patch the eye for an hour, in which case the proximal fusion, tenacious one, is given up, and they'll also spread out. Convergence insufficiency is the only place where perhaps there is some role of exercises. We should know some sort of a control. The one we use is the office control score. We record deviations in the in this method. It's called the White and Brown's record. Upper gaze, primary gaze at distance, at near, down gaze, left gaze, everywhere. We have added refractive correction below, best vision acuity above. We even draw it if it's the right esotropia, it's a snapshot. And we also show underactions, and if they are sore inductions also. This is a snapshot, tells you in one look what is going on in this particular case, helps you plan. Even downshoots and upshoots, you can put curvy arrows or right angle arrows to show upshoots and downshoots and grade them. This is, of course, Duane's retraction syndrome, which is part nowadays of CCDD. So there is always compensatory head posture in some of them. Upshoots, abduction deficits. Here you can see, this is called the melon seed sign because that's what it looks like. It's a huge amount of upshoot. This particular case, we took her up for a differential recession. That means we did medial rectus 6 millimeters, lateral rectus 3, and split it into a Y to prevent upshoots and downshoots. And this is the post-op. You can see how much better the appearance is in a couple of days, a day later. Hardly any of this thing. But don't forget to evaluate the fundus because there could be a dangerous pathology sitting inside, like a retinoblastoma. So that's a must do. Look for fixation. It could be a raised intracranial pressure. I also encourage everybody to pick up their ophthalmoscopes and look at Bruckner's reflexes. They tell you so much. Remember, with the ophthalmoscope, not only do you get a red glow, you also get the corneal reflexes. So you're doing Hirschberg's. You can get an idea of the refractive status because of the crescents. You can swing it around to get an RAPD. The child doesn't feel very threatened with that. It's a little far off. You can diagnose so many other conditions, vitreous hemorrhage or a PHPV with these things. It's the way to go.
Time up, sir.
Yeah, I've kind of finished. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Now, instead of Dr. Krishna Prasad, Dr. Madhu Bataria will talk on neuro-ophthal case.
So, good morning, everybody. I think today elections and everybody's really running all over the place. So let's come down straight to the talk, right? So if a neuro patient comes, how will the patient come to you? So usually there are visual loss, ocular motility disturbances, a simple headache, ptosis, proptosis. It can come in varied forms, may complain of a field defect. Important is to think of TVOs, transient visual obscurations, and TIAs, that my one eye goes blank once in a while, or my hand feels a little numb once in a while. So how do we approach this patient? We do a systematic examination, then we make a good clinical diagnosis, and then we plan the investigations for the treatment. So visual acuity, the vision doesn't mean visual acuity alone. You've got to take it near distance and best corrected. Color vision is extremely important, and so is contrast, field of vision, and Amsler grid. So when you're approaching the exam, I have labeled some items down below. They should be in your bag. Don't run around here there to pick up the items. You can take this entire presentation from my side. This allowed to, you're allowed to take. So now vision loss. A patient comes with sudden vision loss. Now what could be there? It could be a vascular or traumatic. Only two things, right? But if a patient has got subacute, then it becomes a little more. Could be inflammatory cause, or could be a tumor which is suddenly progressed a lot or is bled. And if it's going slow, then usually they are compressive lesions. They could even be nutritional or chronic inflammations inside the brain. Color vision. If a patient reads less than 13 slides, for sure the color vision is defective. Put a red in front of the eye, improves, is congenital, doesn't improve, is acquired. Then coming to the shades differentiation. Farnsworth, Munsell, 100U and 40U. 40U test is free on net, you can download yourself anytime. Now, when do we suspect optic nerve involvement? We suspect when there is worsening of color, the red looks orangish or purplish, or, and these defects of neural system are pertained basically to red. So we also do a color brightness test also, and we can do a red desaturation test. So contrast, the standard chart that all the hospitals have is a Perry-Robson chart. But if an examiner wants a little more, then you can talk about FACT, which has got sinusoidal grating, and that you get a value on the thing in the log units. Coming to field of vision, confrontation test is the day of order of the day in the exams, and you must always do it. You can do it one quadrant, you can do it two quadrants. If you find a scotoma, delineate the scotoma, and after that, once you found something, then you do the brightness comparison also. Like you're seeing my fingers here and here. Are these more bright? These less bright? So if there is a partial field defect, you will get to know that as well. Then coming to Amsler grid, it's really a beautiful thing to have. Usually central scotoma, the patient will not see central spot. What you do is tell the patient, look at the four corners, right? Look at the four corners, and whatever you're seeing irregular or black, just draw that. So that becomes easy for the patient. Another thing to do is that Amsler is again on your telephone app. You can have black, white, black, and black and red. Now comes this. This is the code word. This is because if this is missed, you dilate the patient and you've lost the retrobulbar neuritis, right? So pupil difference of 2 millimeters would be anisocoria if reaction is normal, all right? If the reaction is not normal, then what do we do? These pupillary pathways are all in the books. So you don't need to worry about. What we really need to do is here. We need to do a swinging flashlight or a RAPD. It is RAPD only when one eye is affected. When both eyes are affected, it is APD. So lots of kids say in the exam, madam, both eyes are affected, it's RAPD. It's not RAPD, it's only, then it's a APD. So for RAPD, one eye would dilate, will be a little dilated, the other eye will not. So there are grades of that depending upon the damage. Suppose there's a little damage, then there'll be grade one. What is grade one? Pupil will slightly constrict and then dilate. It's a little more, pupil will stall and then dilate. The third is, it will start dilating with slow. And the fourth will be that it'll just dilate tucked like that. All right? So what you do is you put neutral density filter in front of the normal eye. They're in 0.3 log units, 0.3, 0.6, 0.9, and then you make it both the pupils equal. And that is the amount of quantified loss. Second major thing, they come with ocular motor disorders. And we get third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh. All these nerves are important for the eye. So a patient will be usually a diplopia or a deviation. So we do ductions and versions, and they both will be affected. Now, all the extraocular muscles are supplied by third nerve, except fourth and sixth. So this is, and all the, on the Hess chart, the smaller field will always belong to the eye, which is pereced. So when you see a Hess chart like this, I wish there was a pointer. If you see the smaller thing, can I have a pointer, please? The small thing would be the affected eye, and double or little less than double would be always belonging to the eye, which is a normal eye, right? Then you can have a light near dissociation, and that would be seen mostly in patients of Argyle-Robertson pupil, all right? And if there is a pupil involved with muscle palsies, then it is usually compressive, pupil spared, then it's metabolic. Like a diabetic neuropathy would have a not involved pupil, but a tumor will have an involved pupil. Trochlear nerve or the fourth nerve. This is a little difficult too, but I want you to just focus. This is important for you to know. Look at this child. This eye has got a hypertropia. When the child looks on the affected side, what happens? It's not exaggerated. When the child looks that side, it is exaggerated, and it is exaggerated in all the upper movements. So if you have a small hypertropia, make the patient turn contralateral side. If it increases, it is your fourth nerve. Otherwise, the examiner's classical, they will ask you 3-stage test, head tilt this way and that way. Affected side you do, the head tilt will, the angle will increase. In children, you can take for congenital, you can ask for the old photographs. Some of them may have a facial asymmetry, may have a torticollis also. And you can look at the macula with indirect, and it will be turned because superior oblique is an intorter, so therefore you will find the rotation of the macula. Trigeminal nerve, only corneal sensations. For sixth nerve is the best nerve to have in the exam because this applies only one muscle, which is horizontal. So you can always test, cover test. Primary deviation is less than secondary deviation, and there you are. Complex nerves, cavernous sinus, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth. And cerebellopalatine angle tumor, sixth, seventh, and eighth. If you get nerves like this, you know where you stand. Other than that, if there is something else in the systems, you have to check carefully. Coming to optic atrophy, this is a very common case for the exams. So what you have to really see, you see a pale disc with nearly normal or slightly attenuated, then it is a primary optic atrophy. But if you see a marked thinning of the vessels, then it is likely to be a vascular following a CRAO, right? Then it will happen because of the lesions which are anterior to chiasma. Chiasma and beyond cannot give rise to optic atrophy, right? So you got to also have a site of lesion for that. Usually indicates poor visual prognosis, okay? Genetic counseling also may be required if you're dealing with a case of Leber's, right? But that will not have very clear margins. Margins would be a bit fuzzy in Leber's. And then we have to tell the visual course to this thing also. If it's only unilateral, patient is very old. Don't forget about the anterior ischemic optic neuropathy because that will also look like this. So coming to papilledema, unless until it's in both eyes and it's swollen disc, it is not papilledema. The commonest cause is, or the almost the only thing is raised intracranial pressure. which could be because of a tumor, because of any obstruction, because of even inflammations like early meningitis or something like that, but this will have to be bilateral. Malignant hypertension is another thing which can happen, but that wouldn't give only papal edema, that will give loads of signs, so you will know that what you're dealing with. But unilateral edema could also be there, and that would not be called the papal edema. That we call that a disc edema, and that can happen only, that can happen for multiple reasons. It could be a simple inflammation of, say, papillitis, or could be it could be because of infections. The initial phases of tuberculosis, meningitis, or sometimes in patients when there is orbital cellulitis, that you start getting disc edema. What happened? All right. Then there is compressive and one of these lesions, hereditary, infective. Tumors can also infiltrate, we have to remember it. Tumors and in the fungus, that thing comes from nose, that I'm forgetting the name right now, rhinosporitis. So investigations, we do visual fields. And visual fields, after that, visual fields get give you a finding. Accordingly, we tailor our things. We can do MRI or a CT. We can do VEPs. We can do ERG and optical coherence tomography. But they are, everything is not to be done everybody. ERG basically for toxic neuropathy and nutritional optic neuropathy. VEP for children, malingerers, cortical blindness, multiple sclerosis, ischemic optic neuropathy, optic neuritis, compressive lesions. MRI, all children below 4 years, if they have a fourth nerve palsy, MRI is a must because usually it is compressive. Failure to resume vasculopathies. Just a moment, I have just one slide left. I'm done. So worsening of ocular alignment means palsies increasing, multiple palsies, any isolated nerve palsy with something systemic, like a patient has got a hemiplegia or something like that. And CT, all the contraindications of MRI, you will do a CT. Other than that, you will do in cases of trauma, bony lesions, and evaluation of paranasal sinuses. And sometimes optic nerve head drusen. So with that, I would thank you guys. All the best, and go with a calm head. I'm pretty sure you, all of you will do well. Thanks.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Yes. Is Dr. Krishna Prasad here? Yes, please. Plastic scenario, ptosis, proptosis, ocular tumors.
You're wondering about the dress code, huh?
So today is Valentine's Day. Okay. So for all the guys here, please come to Hall A at 12 o'clock. You have a lot of prizes to win. 5,000 ready cash into the hand for every question answered. There are a lot of questions and 1 lakh for the first prize and many more prizes. Okay, that's why this crowd. Okay. So I hope they're all postgraduates who are going to take the exams. So we'll try to make it like these are the common cases. So you get ptosis. See, please understand how an examination works. If you are setting up an examination center, what cases you're going to keep? Obviously, you're not going to keep a case of, you know, an acute endophthalmitis and acute proptosis with, you know, panophthalmitis. So you don't keep painful cases, or you don't keep. So normally you keep cold cases and the things that normally come to the OPD. See, ptosis comes usually is very common. So, and many a times nowadays proptosis is very difficult to get because there are a lot of orbital surgeons are getting it operated. So nobody walks around with a cavernous hemangioma for years together like in the past to be coming as exam cases. It will be removed very soon. So even the very likely opportunity that you're going to face a ptosis case. So you should know a few things. I'm not going to go to how to examine a case in detail. Basically, if you have a congenital ptosis, which is most common that you get, you should know what case you get. Could be a congenital or an acquired one. In congenital, normally it's a dystrophic LPS. It's what is very important. And it's if it is covering the pupil, then it becomes sight-threatening. Then the treatment has to be imminent, that you can't wait with that. And if a child is having a head posture with a unilateral ptosis, it's a good sign. It is using both eyes. Okay? A head posture with a bilateral ptosis is different. In a unilateral ptosis, if the child is not doing a chin elevation, that means it is likely that it is not using the eye with ptosis. Probably there may be a possibility of. So these are something that you can get it immediately, and we should be warned about it. Okay. A complicated ptosis you can also get if you have got a superior weakness with hypertropia, and you may have, you know, sometimes a jaw winking phenomena. So any jaw winking phenomena is always congenital. You can't have an acquired ptosis with a aberrant innervation. Okay. So this is something that you all should know. This is the order you should know. Senile, aponeurotic, myogenic, neurogenic, traumatic, mechanical. Senile is most common. Aponeurotic, see, please understand, there's an aponeurotic element in the senile ptosis also. Okay, aponeurosis, aponeurotic ptosis means there is a dehiscence or a disinsertion of the aponeurosis leading to, okay, the lid comes down. So even in senile ptosis, there is an aponeurotic component. You can also get aponeurotic ptosis even in young people, adolescents, middle-aged people, because of blepharochalasis, okay, repeated inflammation causing dehiscence. Myogenic, in practice, normally they keep myasthenia or a CPEO, okay, chronic progressive ectal ophthalmoplegia. Whereas neurogenic, all the nerve palsies, you can get Horner's. Traumatic is, history will be obvious, there will be a traumatic ptosis. And mechanical usually is less likely to have. Okay, so you can just, these are very clear by history and by with examination you can make out. This is something has been a bane of the recent years. You know, when we studied post-graduation, these were not there. So MRDs were not there. Okay, so the MRD 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 people are, the list is going on. It's so confusing to understand what it means, and they don't translate into treatment. That is the problem. With MRD 1, MRD 2, MRD 3, you can't really make any sense for treatment. So the simplified workup is, please understand, what is the amount of ptosis? You have cornea vertically 11 millimeters. The first 2 millimeters covered. So from the lid margin to the center of the cornea, or the Hirschberg reflex, there's a 3.5. Because the center is at, let's say, 5.5, which is 11 millimeter cornea. So the lid has to come down to cover the pupillary axis at least by 3.5 millimeters. So if you say you have a ptosis of 2 millimeters, that means the first 2 millimeters normal, then 2 millimeters further down. So you get an idea how much is the ptosis. So up to 2 is mild, 2 to 3.5 is moderate. That means you're almost encroaching the pupillary axis. Anything more than 3.5 will cover the pupillary axis. It's a severe ptosis. So this classification came because of what it does to the vision. Okay, so that is something important. If you have a MRD 1, what you have to do is you have to basically subtract 3.5 from the MRD to get the amount of ptosis. Both mean the same. So you should understand what is the amount of ptosis. You may tell MRD 1, but MRD 1 will not tell us what is the amount of ptosis. You have to tell what is the, how much the lid has drooped down. So that is a better way of telling it. And LPS action by Burke's method, you need to know this. And you should always understand, in a congenital ptosis, the amount of ptosis always matches the amount of LPS action. If you have a good LPS action, you should have a mild ptosis. If you have a very poor LPS action, you will have a severe ptosis. Whereas this does not happen in an aponeurotic ptosis. In an aponeurotic ptosis, you will have a very good LPS action, but the ptosis can be very severe. So this you need to understand. And palpable aperture, up gaze, primary gaze, and down gaze, and Bell's, this is the most important parameter. Whether you have to test as good, fair, poor, or absent, without properly looking at the Bell's, you cannot make any management strategy. And jaw winking phenomena can also be graded. Can be very mild, can be moderate, can be very severe, and the treatment varies. Most important ptosis is the motility. Okay, if you have a superior rectus weakness, if you have an elevation problem, please think, you may have a hypertropia, there may be a pseudoptosis component. Whenever you have a superior rectus weakness, always keep pseudoptosis in mind. Okay, lid lag, lag of thalamus, because post-op you may create more problems to this patient. If a patient already has a pre-op lid lag, lag of thalamus, think about the corneal problem post-op. Okay, so we have, this is the basic management strategy. If you have a mild ptosis, okay, good LPS action, good Bell's, you do fascinal servet. So otherwise you do a fair, you know, LPS action with a good Bell's. Bell's has to be good everywhere, LPS resection. If you have a severe ptosis with the good Bell's and do a frontalis sling, well, there can be small overlaps here and there. And if you have a poor Bell's, no surgery. Okay, at best you can do a crutch glasses. Okay, if you have a senile aponeurotic ptosis, due to an LPS plication or reattachment of the aponeurosis. If you have a jaw winking, you have to disinsert the LPS only for a severe jaw winking, and you have to do a frontalis sling. What if there is a unilateral? Normally it's unilateral, so you may do a other eye, again a sling without a disinsertion to create a symmetry of the lid when the patient looks down. Orbit, Pandora's box, we say, not really, there are too many structures. Normally you're not very familiar with what structures and what kind of tumors that normally you get. Okay. So basically, pseudoproptosis, and you have to look for the prominence of the globe, especially when you have an infection, no? The lid edema can be mistaken. So you have to basically look at the, where is the lid? Okay. So these are infections. So you should understand, whatever history you take is basically to understand whether it's an acute problem or a chronic problem. Acute problems are inflammatory or neoplastic malignant. Chronic ones are usually benign or something structural. Okay, painless, painful, speed of the growth. And this is very important. Basically, what is the age that you're looking at? Okay, and these are the different malignancies that you can have. And this is the thyroid. This is the most common thing. It's very common in the OPD. Be ready for thyroid, as well as look at all the basic, some 10 signs at least you should know. Okay. So what is important is, where is the shift, where is the tumor, and what it is causing? So displacement. So that is very important. History is very important because you have to look at the onset and progression. You have to look for vision loss. In normally, in case of malignancies, there will be a vision loss because it involves the optic nerve. It involves the nerve, so there is pain. And also it causes a motility problem because it infiltrates the muscles. So if you have a vision loss, if you have pain, if you have double vision, then you look for a malignant lesion or an inflammatory lesion. If these are not there, if normally benign tumors are long-standing.
You're finished? Please wind up. We have 2 more.
Okay, I'll just... Okay, I'll just take another 30 seconds. So lid tumors, you have normally 3. Squamous cell carcinoma, which is comes from the skin, basal cell from the skin, and normally the most common that you get is the meibomian cell carcinoma, which is basically not from the skin, from the tarsal plate. So make sure that you understand this, very important. This is the most common thing kept in the exam nowadays. It is from the tarsal plate. There's a thickening of tarsal plate. The skin is usually intact, and there's a loss of eyelashes. So this is something that you need to know, and the management protocol, and there are various things that you need to understand. I think, okay? So I think all the best for your exams. And these are the cases, you are not necessarily for the exam that you need to know, but these are the state that we normally encounter in our practice. So I think for our patients, I think we should be expert about this. Thank you very much, and all the best for your future.
Thank you. For this lack of time, we'll be just taking the 2 speakers left, Major General Sagarika and Dr. Rathinam. Please, if you could really limit it to 9 minutes, that we have some time for discussion left. Thank you.
So we're just going to talk about how and what we're going to do when you have a retina case during exams. Mostly when you have a retina case, patients, the residents, they actually become very, very upset. So this is in order to remove those upsets. So we have, let's say, for example, you get a 50-year-old male who's non-diabetic, he's hypertensive, he's non-smoker, non-alcoholic. He just had difficulty in vision in the left eye for last 3 days. You look at his vision is absolutely normal. Fundus in the right eye was absolutely normal, but in the left eye, you find that there's dilatation and tortuosity of the Benny segment, which is distal to the site of occlusion. Attenuation was proximally present, and you find that there are large flame-shaped hemorrhages, retinal edema, cotton wool spots. So you now classify it. What is it? It is a first-order temporal branch away from the disc, but involving the branch to the macula. This is a major BRVO. So how do you approach a patient who's got a vitreoretinal disorder? So you have to do a comprehensive examination. The first important is history, and in which vision, as I said, is extremely important. We'll go into it later. You must do a slit lamp examination because that will also give you a lot of clues. And you must do a fundus examination, and then finally you go into investigations. How can you examine the fundus? We are all aware. We can do it by direct, indirect slit lamp. In direct ophthalmoscopy, what I want you to understand is that there is no stereopsis. Your working distance is only 2 to 3 centimeters. Field of view is only 5 degrees. And by the indirect ophthalmoscope, we are able to get a real inverted image. You can get good magnification. Your field of view is much larger. Your optimum working distance is much larger. You've got very good illumination and stereopsis. You can use a scleral indenter, and you have varied type of lenses between 14 to 30 diopters, and you have to position your patient. So you first adjust your headband of your indirect ophthalmoscope. It's very good and comfortable to use your own indirect ophthalmoscope in exams, because then you're not fiddling with other things which you're not very aware of, because different ophthalmoscopes may be slightly different, and that time you are under a little state of shivers and tremors, so it's always better to use your own. And then once you have fixed up your headband, then you hold the lens comfortably, use your pivot, and then after that examine the eye. Very, very commonly used lenses, which one? Anyone for answering? 20 diopters, isn't it? That's the commonest lens. Now, you can use the scleral indenters, or commonly asked questions, which are the scleral indenters that you use? They can be thimble scleral indenter, depressor, pencil, and the cotton-tipped applicator can also be used. And what are you examining with that? You are examining the periphery between the equator and the aura by creating a mold. That means you're pushing it in, and with that, you're being able to see. How do you start it? You'd start from the supero-nasal area, go to the superior area, superotemporal, inferotemporal, inferior, inferonasal. You follow that route so that you don't miss out on anything. So this is how you position your patient, and then you place your chart. The chart is placed upside down, isn't it? Once you do that, after that you start your drawing. You must have your colored pencils with you, and after that, please understand that you must draw it in that manner, because definitely it's going to give you good brownie points, because the people will be happy. Now, what is the color of detached retina? Anyone from here? It's blue, isn't it? Attached retina is red. And of course, you've got vitreous exudates, you've got lattice, which is so commonly found. So you have to then, and you have to identify where do you draw. So this is the equator. Up to this, you can remember see even with a 90 diopters lens. And then comes the aura. And finally, this is the junction between the pars plicata and the pars plana. So this is what you must identify in your head, that this is what you're seeing. And in order to draw it, you must use your colors, as I said. Attached retina is in red. The blue is the detached retina. You can see a horse shape there. And you can also see lattice with holes. Once you draw that, it becomes very easy. Now, once you've done a good, thorough examination of the retina, then you go in for investigation. So in this particular case, per patient, blood pressure, ECG, you've got to ask for the blood counts. You may not have them, but you must ask for it. For those who are below 50 years of age, you must have a chest x-ray, blood, etc. And now, the next investigation, which again you can't do during your exams, but suppose it's provided for you, okay, this is your FFA, then you've got to check whether there's any delayed venous filling, is there blood which has been blocked, a blockage by blood, let's say, there's hyperfluorescence or hyperperfusion, etc. So you've got to see. Now this, in the left eye was abnormal, but in the right eye, the FFA was normal. Of course, you can do an OCT, which again will give you a lot of findings. And then of course, you follow up the patient and accordingly treat it. The second common type of case that may come to you is, for example, this is a 26-year-old male patient who had blurring of vision in both the eyes. It was painless, slowly progressive, and there was associated with redness and no systemic features, and you see that the vision in the left eye was 624 and there were cells, so therefore your slam examination is very important, otherwise you'll miss it. So there were also retrolenticular cells. This is the fundus picture, which is showing you clearly that there was sheathing and active uveitis, vasculitis present. This was the fundus picture, and now this is, mind you, in both the eyes he had this. So don't forget to examine the fellow eye also. And this, of course, is fundus fluorescein angiography, which is telling you a lot. If you take both the things, we realize that the patient had bilateral uveitis. Of course, the investigations have to be done, in which ESR, Montu's chest x-ray, homocysteine, RA factor, etc. should be done. Again, an optical coherence tomography is of great importance. It will help you. And the diagnosis, therefore, what? It's a bilateral peripheral uveitis, commonly known as Eales disease, with a superotemporal BRVO. And of course, you can manage the patient. Now, the third patient commonly obtained got is 26-year-old male. He had an RD operated elsewhere. His vision was 636 in that eye. He just came for a routine examination. In the left eye, his vision was 6x6. But when we examined him, we found that there was, as you can see, that there is a retinal detachment which is present inferiorly, almost reaching up to the inferior arcade. Very important that you should note, there was no history of sudden appearance or disturbance in the visual field. There was no loss of central vision. There were no flashes of light or floaters. There was, you have to ask for large floaters, for example, which will tell you that maybe a PVD or an operculum. If there are numerous floaters, we know that there can be a sudden vitreous hemorrhage. So you must not forget that sudden loss of vision can be because of an RD that has gone up, almost up to the macula, or a vitreous hemorrhage, and rarely an accidental finding. You might suddenly find an inferior RD. That is why you must examine the fellow eye, which is one mistake the people out of sheer fright forget to do that. And therefore, your history and examination become very important. You have to do investigations. You must consider what are the differential diagnosis and your all the after collating all the findings. And then, of course, you have to go to determine what type of surgery. So I have already told you about this. And when will you consider imaging? When there is hazy media. In that case, you can do a B scan. You can do CT, MRI, and also to determine if there is a foreign body. Of course, if there is a foreign body and you think it may be a metallic one, don't forget, don't do an MRI. Don't do a CT. Now, what are the features of a rhabdomyosarcoma RD? We know it has a convex surface and borders. It starts around the break, progresses to the aura serrata, continues dependently, and progresses. It may even progress up to the disc. The final shape depends upon iris adhesions, whether there's old cryo present, laser marks may be present, which will tell you that, whether the retina will be pale or it may be edematous. There may be undulating movements, must be hunted for. Superior breaks, remember 75% superotemporal quadrant. It is normally present over there, therefore hunt for that area earlier. And inferior breaks, they have very slow progression. They may also have demarcation lines. So you must investigate how many quadrants have been involved, whether there is macula is on or off. If it is off, you must do early surgery. If it is on, it's an emergency. Don't forget that, it's an emergency. And you must know, remember Linkoff's rules to find the primary break. This must be in your heads all the time. And therefore, you know that 50% you might have one break, 32 breaks and 22%. So to summarize, FFA, OCT are very important, but they don't form the basis of diagnosis of all vitreoretinal disorders. Most important is a good clinical history and examination. This forms the foundation of your diagnosis and management, and you must record your findings in the proper method that you have been taught. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Such a lucid presentation. We have Dr. Ratnam, the UVR, famous UVR expert, to give you tips on UVR case, which again will be invariably a part of your exams.
Good morning, children. It is very, very important to know uveitis, even though it appears to be a little tough, but it is important because it can come as a short case, it can come as a fundus, it can come in instruments, it can come in investigation also in viva. So I will just concentrate only on the questions which will be asked in each section. Usually, they ask you to differentiate episcleritis with scleritis. I'm not asking you because lack of time, and I'll be telling you the answer as well. It's a bright red in color, and it is painless. There is no tenderness, and phenylephrine test is positive. Whereas in scleritis, it is not bright red, but it is a hue that is around that, and it is tender. Patient gives history of pain, and phenylephrine test is negative. It will not become pale after application of phenylephrine. And also, one very important thing, in between the vessels, you will see the redness in scleritis. In episcleritis, in between the vessels, sclera will be white. So it is very, very typical, in between the vessels, you see the redness in scleritis. And nodular scleritis is just seen in one portion, whereas diffuse anterior scleritis is seen everywhere. So if the examiner is asking you the diagnosis, you just say whether it is anterior diffuse episcleritis or scleritis, or it is nodular scleritis. And scleral abscess, obviously you will see the abscess point pointing out to you. So usually you will not be asked to culture sensitivity test, but if they ask you, the management, probably you will tell about scleral incision and taking for culture and sensitivity, and depending upon the culture results, you will be starting the treatment. Posterior scleritis, pericorneal congestion will not be there, but near limbal congestion will be more. So farnesial congestion is more in posterior scleritis. And you can see at the angles also the congestion. In addition, fundus examination may show you disc edema and also choroidal folds. So posterior scleritis, important clinical signs are disc edema and choroidal folds. Now coming to uveitis per se, now we have seen episcleritis, scleritis, posterior scleritis. Now we are coming to uveitis. Hypopyon, very, very important. If you have, if the examiner has hypopyon case, definitely they will take hypopyon. The causes of hypopyon, HLA-B27, leptospirosis, Behçet's syndrome, lens-induced, masquerade, and endophthalmitis. And this case is a post-operative endophthalmitis. You can see the lens as well as the hypopyon. And mutton fat keratic precipitate, where do you see? Tuberculosis, sarcoidosis, lens-induced, VKS, sympathetic ophthalmia, masquerade syndrome, and endogenous endophthalmitis. This is very important. And when you see non-granulomatous, usually HLA-B27 uveitis. You will see hypopyon there also. Hyphema, where do you see hyphema? Traumatic uveitis, UGH syndrome after lens, misplaced lens, lens-induced uveitis. Even in normal leaking Marganglian cataract, you can see hyphema, Fuchs uveitis, viral uveitis, and neovascularization. And pattern loss, this is a typical case of pattern loss. Usually you say iris, color and pattern altered. And this is the way color and pattern is altered. This is usually seen in sarcoid uveitis and viral uveitis. And posterior synechiae, ring synechiae, which causes shallowing of the anterior chamber. So this is an extreme shallowing of anterior chamber here. Peripheral anterior synechiae, usually either trauma or tuberculosis, sarcoidosis, and rheumatoid granuloma in south. And the important differentiating points between retinitis and choroiditis, in retinitis, you see bright red color, and vessels along the lesion will be affected. You see vasculitis here, whereas in choroid, it is dull yellow color, and overlying vessel will not be affected. Here you have very good example of retinitis with vasculitis, choroiditis with vasculitis. Choroiditis is usually well circumscribed. Retinitis is fuzzy. See, can you tell me whether it is retinitis or choroiditis? Retinitis. It's a very good case of retinitis. This case also has disc hyperemia and neuroretinitis. Neuroretinitis with retinitis is usually dengue. What is this? Retinitis or choroiditis? Choroiditis. Overlying vessel is absolutely all right. Media is absolutely clear. So this is choroiditis. So media is clear in choroiditis. Media is hazy in retinitis. What is this? Again, choroiditis. Vessels are not involved at all, and the superior portion healed choroiditis with pigmentation. This is very typical of tuberculosis. Chronologically, older lesion will be seen, and also newer lesions are there, and vessel is not involved. What do you see here? Candle wax appearance of sarcoid vasculitis. See the blood vessel and also the dots. So candle wax dripping in sarcoid vasculitis. What is this? String of pearl appearance in leptospirosis. You have disc hyperemia, free floating vitreous membrane, and string of pearl appearance. This is leptospirosis. Beautiful string of pearl appearance. What do you see here? What is the diagnosis? Occlusive vasculitis, pale disc is always Behçet's. Occlusive vasculitis, in a case, in uveitis clinic, hypopia and uveitis, occlusive vasculitis, pale disc with history of mouth ulcer is almost always Behçet's. Whereas in sarcoid, you will have exudative vasculitis, which will be perivascular sheathing. In tuberculosis, perivascular sheathing. Leptospirosis, perivascular sheathing. Occlusive vasculitis, you see only in Behçet's and Eales disease. In Eales disease, you will not have mouth ulcer, but in Behçet's, you will have mouth ulcer. And the peripherally, you see the retinitis healing with pigmentation. You can have retinitis in case of Behçet's. What is this? Healed chorioretinal scars along the vessels is 100% tuberculosis. This is extensive chorioretinal scars in tuberculosis. And exudative RD with granulomatous panuveitis, I would like to give differential diagnosis, either VKH, sympathetic ophthalmia, sarcoid and TB. Here there is no history of trauma, so sympathetic ophthalmia gets ruled out, and the examiner will ask you which investigation you will do. You will answer that it is ultrasound and FFA. That rules out other possibilities, fixing up the diagnosis of VKH. So you just give the clinical description like age of the patient, acute nature, bilaterality, severe, granulomatous, panuveitis, fundus finding with exudative RD, and this is the diagnosis you are going to give, and give the differential diagnosis alone, then it is much easier to face the examiner. Give only clinical description and differential diagnosis, you are very, very safe.
Thank you. We got it. 10 minutes late and we are bang on time, so please next ones can just come in. Dr. Amitava and me are okay if you take our slides from there, okay? Other people may have copyright issues, so if the residents want Dr. Kirti Singh or Dr. Amitava's slide, they can take it, okay? All the best for your exams. Any question, we'll take it outside because we have run out of time. Thank you.